is called as the ball valve mechanism. This is important in case of males. Okay. Because this is because of this chromastic muscle. Okay. As your friend said, there is something called as chromastic reflex. You know what is chromastic reflex? Chromastic reflex. Yeah, what is it?
Okay.
If you just give a prick at this particular point, prick, suddenly this muscle contracts. Okay. And it pulls the testis upwards. Okay. What he said is also okay. Okay, but that is not chromastic reflex. If you want to check this muscle, they just give a stroke on the medial side of the scrotum or the lateral side of the scrotum, and then suddenly this muscle contract. This muscle will contract and it pulls the testicle upwards. So it is like a ball pulling upwards. And what happens when it pulls upwards? It closes the superficiating one of ring. So this is called as the ball valve mechanism. It's like a ball valve. Valves, you know?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So it is going and closing the mouth of the superficial inguinal ring. Okay. So that is why it is called as the valve mechanism, or it is also called as the chromaster when it helps in plugging out these spermatic cords. Benefit. So, yeah, it is an advantage in case of the male that we have the valve mechanism. Okay. Which prevents the hernias, but still hernias are common in case of male, even after that. Okay. The third is the shuttle mechanism. Okay, shuttle mechanism. As I said, the internal oblique as well as the transverse abdominis muscle are arching on that. Okay, you know the shuttles, when your car enters your house, the shuttle will come down like this. Similarly, whenever these muscles contract, internal oblique as well as transverse abdominis, this will be pulled down.
So two muscles, not two.
Yeah. Internal oblique, mainly the internal oblique, along with the transverse abdominis also, partly. Okay. Okay. So it will be coming down and it closes. Okay. Closes and it will be totally just holding the structures inside it and totally covers it. This is called as the shutter mechanism. Then there is also called as something called as the slit valve mechanism. Okay. If you see the external oblique muscle. The external oblique muscle, when it is getting inserted at this pubic crest, So he's imagining, he's seeing the movie. How exactly the mechanisms are working. And the fourth method, slit valve, is the external oblique, when it gets inserted at this point, it splits into two. And this superficial inguinal ring is between the two slits of the external oblique. So whenever the external oblique contracts, it compresses this opening. Okay. So this is called as the slit valve mechanism. All these mechanisms are preventing the hernia. Okay. And if these mechanisms don't work, then it leads to the formation of the hernia. Okay. Along with that, as your friend said, the hormonal, which gives the strength to the abdominal wall. Okay. Which one? Testosterone. Okay. Okay. Now coming to the hernia. What is hernia? As you know, this is the nothing but the abnormal protrusion of the abdominal contents through this canal, through the abdominal wall, through the inguinal. If it is through the inguinal canal, then it is called an inguinal hernia. If it is through any other openings, then it is called as the hernias. Okay. There are different types of hernia. We will talk about that. Okay. 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 So, as you can see in this picture, we have different types of hernia. One of the important hernias is the inguinal hernia, which is of two types. One is direct and indirect hernia. Okay, we'll talk about that. Okay. Coming to the applied aspects, the inguinal hernias, okay, which is direct as well as indirect hernia. Then there are other types of hernias within the inguinal, that is reducible. As your friend was telling, when he can lie down, it will be reduced. That is reducible. Sometimes it is irreducible. But the most complicated will be the irreducible, especially if it is strangulated. If it is strangulated, what happens? There will be ischemia, and that leads to necrosis, and that might, the necrosis part will might drain into the peritoneum and it spreads into the whole abdomen and he might the person die. Okay. Okay, so that is this strangulated. Within the direct, again there is a direct medial and direct lateral, congenital, again there are many types. Okay, all these are the types. We're not going to those types. One important type we'll see is the difference between direct and indirect. What is direct hernia? What is indirect hernia?
Direct, maybe this inside the canal.
With cuff, let's go and
enter through the canal. It's
protrude and come back.
Which one?
Indirect.
Indirect. What about direct?
It's still there.
Okay. Anything else? What is the difference between direct and indirect?
From the wall.
Huh?
From the wall. After wall.
Okay.
I think it goes from the superficial or from the deep itself.
Which one?
Exactly.
What is the difference?
External ring or internal ring?
Yes.
Yeah. I forget about this.
Direct will enter to the ring. On the
direct will enter the ring.
Yes.
Which one?
The direct.
Superficial or deep?
Superficial.
Deep is direct.
Direct is the examination with your heart.
Okay, that is examination. We'll talk about the examination later. First, what you should know. If you want to, this is what the confusion will be there if you don't understand the concept. Okay, try to understand the concept, then easily it can. Okay. That means it is directly coming out. What does it mean? If there is weakness in the abdominal wall, then it will come through directly through the superficial inguinal ring. Okay.
Without enter to the ring, deep?
Without entering the deep.
Mm-hmm. This is the direct.
In case of the indirect, it passes through the regular process, like other contents. It will pass through the deep inguinal ring, passes through the canal and comes to the superficial. Direct is direct. If there is weakness in the abdominal wall, the wall is not strong. So all will open and it will enter through directly through the superficial inguinal ring. Where do you put?
An examination.
In the examination. Okay, we'll talk about that in the examination later. Okay. So how do you identify the difference between the direct and indirect? Okay. So here there is an important artery one which I was talking about, inferior epigastric artery. Okay. If the hernial content comes medial to the inferior epigastric artery, then it is direct because it is coming through directly to the superficial without passing through a deep by the abdominal wall. Weakness in the abdominal wall, it pierces all the abdominal wall and comes to the superficial. So it is medial to the inferior epigastric artery. But in case of the indirect, it passes through a deep to the canal and superficial. Okay, so it is lateral to the inferior epigastric artery.
This is the what? This is the indirect?
This is indirect, which is lateral.
Yes.
Direct is direct. Okay, as you can remember. Okay.
Doctor, how during development of the...
No. Okay. Direct hernias, it is because of the weakness of the wall. We'll talk about that. Okay. This is, when is the weakness of the abdominal wall? In the older age. But okay, in the older age, the muscles become weak at that time, so the direct hernias are more common in the old age. Indirect hernias, this can be congenital, as you said. Okay, so here you can see the congenital. Okay, because as I said, there might be patent process vaginalis through which the hernia can easily come. As well as if there is any other, weakness in the deep as well as superficial inguinal ring, all these types of hernias can happen. So the indirect hernias are more common in case of the infantile or the congenital age group, and the direct hernias are more common in the old age group. Okay. There are some other hernias apart from these hernias, inguinal hernias. As you can see, one of the important hernia which I was talking about, when I said the best point to take incision will be the linea alba because it is blood vessel, very few blood vessels, so least vascular, so less bleeding. But what happened later when they started doing, they felt, this quite a big, the weakness, because the linea alba is least vascular, what is the complication?
No healing.
No healing, good. So there will be no healing, so there is weakness in the wall now. You did the operation very well, no blood loss, so it was good for the surgeon, but not for the patient. So because there was no blood supply, no healing was there, So that will lead to incisional hernia. It is not only here, it is common in other parts also, but it is most commonest here. So now they stop doing surgeries on this part. Okay, now they do it on the abdominal wall itself. Okay, so that is called an incisional hernia. Apart from that, there can be other types of hernia, like the epigastric hernia, umbilical hernia, but the commonest will be the femoral hernia. There is femoral canal in the thigh through which the contents can come out, and that is called the femoral hernia. These are some of the other types of hernia.
Incisional? Yes, it is actually, since the patient is without surgery.
Without surgery, incisional hernia will not be there. Wherever you do the incisions,
yes.
If there is hernia through that particular incisional part, then it's called an incision.
Okay.
Right?
Okay. It's because of what, doctor?
Because of the weakness of the abdominal wall, because of incomplete healing. It is commonest in any incision, any part,
what's
but it content? Is most commonest here. Okay. But
content?
It can come.
What are the contents of
that? That one? Abdominal content, any content. It doesn't have to be particular. Okay, any content which is coming protruding through the abdomen. Sometimes, if it is especially in the pelvis, the content of the hernia can be different types. Sometimes it is urinary bladder, sometimes it can be the fallopian tubes, ovaries in case of the females, uterus, sometimes it can be intestine. Usually the commonest will be intestine because they are freely mobile everywhere. They are long extended. So it can be intestine, sometimes it can be bladder or some other contents also. Okay. So the content can be different in different regions. If it is in different parts, it can be different. Okay. Now, one more important objective is there. You should know the difference between the direct as well as the indirect hernia. Okay, I have told you. We'll just revise the things. Okay. The indirect hernia, as I said, it enters through the deep inguinal ring, passes through the canal and comes to the superficial inguinal. So it is passing through the deep inguinal ring. But in case of the direct, this is also passing through the superficial, but not the deep. It doesn't pass through the deep and then pass through the canal. It directly, because of the weakness of the wall, it will be an opening behind the superficial inguinal ring. And then it comes suddenly through the superficial inguinal ring. Okay. And it passes through a triangle called as the Hasselbeck's triangle. What is this Hasselbeck's? We'll go back to the picture again, once again, and we'll see. There is something called as Hasselbeck's triangle. So here, this is called as the Hasselbeck's triangle. Okay. So laterally, it is formed by the inferior epigastric artery. Medially, it will be the lineal buff, and below will be the inguinal ligament. So that is the Hasselbeck's triangle here on either side. So if this content is coming through this, then it is the direct hernia. Okay. And the best way is to see whether it is coming lateral to the inferior epigastric artery or medial to the inferior epigastric artery. So this is it enters to the inguinal triangle of the Hasselbeck's. Okay. So that is the first difference. The second is hernia, neck of the hernial sac lies lateral to the inferior epigastric. As I said, it passes through the lateral. Here it will be medial to the inferior epigastric. The third is, as I said, it will be usually in young age. Indirect, congenital.
Yes.
Okay. And it will be usually unilateral. Because it can be one side or two side. Really it is two side. Usually it will be one side, which is incompletely closed, processus generalis centered. But in case of the indirect, it is because of the weakness in the wall. When it is weakness, it is throughout, right?
Yeah.
So it will be usually bilateral, and it is in case of the old age. Then indirect, as I said before, it is congenital. In case of the direct, it will be acquired because it is in old age. Okay. Indirect hernia, because it is taking all the contents through this whole process, so it covers all the coverings of the spermatic cord, because it is passing through the sperm along with the spermatic cord, so it will take all the coverings of the spermatic cord. But direct, it is coming directly without the spermatic cord, okay, through the wall, so that's why it doesn't have all the coverings.
Okay.
And the direction, as it is coming from the lateral side to the medial side, it is directed downwards medially. And
this is doctor, and that can be unilateral in old age.
Which one?
Indirect.
Indirect. It will be usually unilateral.
Usually unilateral. Old or
yeah.
Young?
Old is rarely, but still it can be there. Okay. But if it is congenital, then usually it will be in the early age.
Yes.
Okay.
But not always it's congenital.
Hmm?
Not always it's congenital.
Yeah, not always it is congenital. Okay.
Doctor.
Okay.
In case of direct hernia, the contents will be just under the skin or there is layer?
Yeah, just under the skin. always it will be just under the skin, in the scrotum. Sometimes it is called as the scrotal hernias, when the, all the contents will come up to the scrotum. Okay, sometimes they don't go enter into the scrotum, they will be somewhere here, okay, they don't enter the scrotum, okay. So how to differentiate, you were asking about this clinical difference, okay. So this is just to show you the deep, it is the indirect passing through the deep inguinal ring, this is the abdomen, right? The contents are coming through the deep inguinal ring, passing through, this is the process, patent process vaginalis. So it is passing along the contents into the superficial and then from there into the scrotum, okay. In case of the direct, see here it is not coming through, here is a deep inguinal ring, it is not passing through here, but it is penetrating the wall of the abdomen, this is the wall of the abdomen. So it is penetrating directly and coming out into the superficial inguinal. This is the difference between the right, the direct and indirect. Okay. Okay. Now to how to check, how to differentiate clinically. To check, there is a point here, that is called as the mid-inguinal point. Okay. That is the point where the inguinal ligament is at the center. So that is the point where the deep inguinal ring is present. Okay, mid-inguinal point is the point where the deep inguinal ring is there. So ask the person to lie down, ask if it is reducible hernia, ask him to lie down, relax and reduce it manually, or if he lies down, it will reduce it automatically. Once it is reduced, apply pressure on that particular point. Mid-inguinal point. Okay. Then ask him to stand and cough or something like that.
Yes.
Okay. If it is passing through a deep inguinal ring, because you are applying the pressure on that directly.
Stop.
Okay. So it will stop. So no content will come here. So then you indicate that it is indirect, because indirect will pass through a deep inguinal ring.
Okay.
But in case of the superficial, this direct hernia, because you are applying the pressure here, but the content is not coming through here. It is coming through directly because of the weakness of the wall here. It is coming through directly. So if you are applying pressure, no use, because it has coming direct. So you can easily identify if there is a swelling, then it indicates that it is
direct or indirect can be reducible.
Yeah, direct or indirect, they can be reducible when they are reducible. Sometimes there will be irreducible.
Okay.
And strangulated, you cannot reduce at all unless you give the incision, cut the structures around. Okay, this is all about the abdominal hernias, and you know the lymphatic drainage, it will be to the superficial and deep group of inguinal group of hernias. Okay, this is all about the hernias. Okay, one more important thing I missed. Is this rectus sheath, rectus muscle is there here. If you see the rectus muscle, I don't know why the slide missed or what. When we are talking about the rectus muscle, okay. So here, if you see here, there is rectus sheath on the rectus muscle. Okay. If you see here, there are some lines here. These are called as tendinous intersections. Tendinous, yeah, six packs. Because of this tendinous intersection, you can see the six packs here. Okay. This is present only in the anterior wall. Anteriorly, which is in contact with the rectus sheath. So rectus sheath will be in the front like this here. Okay, and this tendinous intersection will be connection between the rectus sheath and the this rectus abdominis muscle. Okay.
It is a bit after to the exercise. Yes?
It will appear prominently after exercise. Okay, but it will be present.
It will be present all just time. Only in this in one muscle.
Yeah, only in this muscle.
Okay. It is behind the aponeurosis.
Yeah.
Not
rectus sheath means aponeurosis.
No, I mean the tendineus.
Yeah.
Behind the aponeurosis.
It is connecting the aponeurosis with the muscle.
Okay.
So it is connection between the muscle and. So if when you reflect the anterior wall of the rectus sheath, you cannot, because there are tendineous intersections.
So it is normally it is present.
Normally it is present. Yeah.
So after the exercise.
Prominent, it looks prominent, okay. But in case of the posterior wall, there are no tendons in intersection. So there is no contact between the posterior wall and the rectus abdominis muscle. Only it is present in the anterior wall. Okay. I think I have somewhere.